funeral industry is one of the last that still enjoys our trust. But there is growing evidence that such trust is often misplaced. Exposure goes undercover to reveal disturbing changes. The funeral industry is one of the last that still enjoys our trust. But there is growing evidence that such trust is often misplaced. Exposure goes undercover to reveal disturbing changes taking place within Britain's unregulated funeral industry.
Just keep yourself nice and airborne. Put it on.
We reveal disrespect towards the bereaved and the dead. Racism.
Burn the fucking drive,
you fucking peggy.
Fucking Muslim bastard, she's a burnt bastard.
Bodies left out to decompose.
I'm weaking lately. Like fucking wrong. It must be the weather and breaking down quicker.
This stinks, man.
And the length some funeral directors will go to drum up business.
One afternoon, you buy a cheap bingo set, and apparently all these old girls and old boys love it in a nursing home. And the idea is when they die, they may use buildings like that.
Most funeral directors still look like the family-run businesses on your local high street that you would trust in a time of need. But despite appearances, over 40% of the UK's funeral directors are now owned by just four companies. Companies who prefer to trade using the old and trusted family name. Two reporters, Luke Den and Tom Ellis, are each going undercover in two of these companies. They will spend months secretly filming to find out whether these corporate takeovers are changing the British funeral industry, which is worth over £1 billion a year. Tom is starting as a casual worker at Gilman Funeral Service, a group of six funeral homes that enjoy a long-standing reputation in South London. 2 years ago, Roger Gilman sold up to a company called Funeral Partners Limited, who have bought up 70 funeral directors in the UK. FPL are mentioned on a certificate in each branch, but the businesses still look like they did before they were bought out. One branch in Battersea even displays a sign claiming it's still an independent family funeral director. What you won't find on the website or on company literature is that August Equity, a private equity firm with a portfolio of £300 million, own a 60% controlling share of FPL. But when a business still looks like a family-run affair, how much research are bereaved families likely to do? Christian Twig Flesner is Professor of Commercial Law at the University of Hull.
Consumers should have the right to choose, in this case, whether they want to go with a small family-run company or a large-scale commercial operator.
On the website, it is possible to find out who the real owner of these undertakers is. You have to hunt around on the website until you get to that information. This is not the kind of thing people will do at a time when they're trying to arrange a funeral.
August Equity described themselves as operating within the most attractive sectors in the UK. Managing the Gilman's Group is Merv Moyes, a former used car salesman who was brought in to improve performance.
Morning.
At a monthly business meeting, Merv explains that business is booming.
Yet again in May, we had an exceptionally good month and we put quite a bit of money on the bottom line. Market share, we've actually increased, which has been absolutely fabulous. We were sitting at 20.3% and we're now 23.2%. It doesn't seem a lot on figures, but it's, believe you me, that's a big chunk of a market share. So it shows that people are coming back to us. We did that.
But the company is still hungry for more. A
couple of things what the company would think about doing is community projects. Success is one day a week we send a member of staff to hold a bingo at the nursing home. And apparently that's brought in huge...
I'd be a bingo caller. Bring it on. I might offend them, but I'll...
One afternoon, you buy a cheap bingo set, and apparently all these old girls and old boys love it in a nursing home. And the idea is when they die, They may use Gilman's, I don't know.
Despite the healthy income, staff complain that funerals are now regularly undermanned and Merv isn't allowed to hire more full-time employees.
When these men are on their funerals and four men turn up to carry a casket, that's not on. It's really not on.
Trying to get casual staff around here, Rachel, is difficult.
If we're having a problem with casuals, then is it easier not to get another full-time staff member in?
He will not employ full-time bearers at all. But I can add four or five casuals, as many casuals as I
want. But we're not got the casuals.
So I can't do full-time at all at the moment.
But it doesn't look the same old-school Gilman. There used to be six men on a coffin.
Many of the staff worked at Gilman's before the takeover, and they are increasingly unhappy about what they are being asked to do.
They want you to promote anything that promotes bringing in the dead, we'll do it.
They also claim they're expected to do jobs that professional tradesmen should be doing.
You've got a leaking roof and you send Gary up there to fix it. Get a fucking roof for your tight. You've got millions. That's what makes me laugh. They've got fucking millions, but yet they want to send the cheapest option.
That's why they're doing it.
Yeah, exactly.
Before they start sending me out as a fucking
bailiff. Yeah, you know what I mean?
But how much attention is manager Merv paying to the behaviour of staff? The company promised they will act with respect, integrity, and always to the highest professional standards. Within his first week, and without any training, Tom is put to work. Helping Rachel, the embalmer, and Paul, a driver-bearer, to prepare a body for a family viewing.
Is this the second day of funerals?
This is my first, like, yeah, proper one. I've been to a few.
Cool.
Yeah.
Has he got makeup on?
Yep, he doesn't need it. Yeah.
So you don't want to get out of the
fitter, isn't it? No, I'm suffocating.
To protect the makeup job, they cover the deceased's head with a plastic shopping bag.
This is really crap.
This doesn't look like acceptable practice, but it doesn't trouble Merv, the boss, when he arrives to help out.
Strong. Sitting up is how you dress a living person. So a dead person.
Yeah.
You roll the bum. Look front and back. Well, when he does it, he just like, whoa! You know those magicians who pull the tablecloth out? That's what he does. He rips it.
Rachel, the embalmer, is one of just three members of staff with any industry-related qualifications. She claims to be overworked and has to rely on whichever unskilled worker happens to be around. In this case, Lee.
She got clothes on? Yeah, hang on, we need to strip her first. Dun, 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 dun. The minute she walks in the portrait at the death.
You what you like, eh? What you like.
I'm not going, mate. Now, can you roll the bum to your little and I'll stick it under there?
Oh, hello.
Thank you. You want to go as well?
I'm sure she will. That be off for you.
Right,
now. Come on, sweetheart, get your ass up.
Hey. I'm trying.
Oh, yeah.
Yuck, black hair, look at that one, it's gross.
Oh, don't pick it.
Well, I can't leave it there.
Why not?
The family will see it.
So I'll have supper. For sure.
Yeah.
Well, you can't get her on, mate.
Oh, push again.
Yep, it's possible.
With such a grim job, some gallows humour is understandable. But at Gilman's, this all too easily slips into disrespect.
This is just a sore. Scum. That's why I'm not sure it's him. Just a scum.
Just a scum.
Don't say that, though.
What is this?
Yeah. How's Tom?
Yeah, I'm all right, you?
Good, thanks.
Good, good.
Away from family's eyes, the culture of disrespect continues. The staff make inappropriate jokes after collecting someone's ashes in an urn.
Do you know what her favourite dance was?
What's that?
The Riddler.
while driving a body to a funeral in a hearse. Staff share porn on a mobile phone. And at the Slough branch of FPL, the bereaved are disrespected too.
I've got a family.
FPL are members of the National Association of Funeral Directors and proudly display their code of practice in the reception area. They claim that these codes will be honoured by their professionally trained staff. The Gilman's branches charge a total of £1,260 for transport and care of the deceased and professional services. But Tom is assigned to work alongside Paul, who will mentor him, despite having no formal qualifications relating to the preparation of a body.
Is that a woman or not? Who's that geezer? Hey?
Nevertheless, he's teaching Tom how to prepare a body for a funeral.
Sounds... She was upside down, didn't she? Right, we've got to get her over.
So
bring that closer. Right, bring her legs over. Yep, all right. Might as well get her into the cover then. Then you go make sure this is stuffed, make sure.
Yeah.
Paul has been left to cover a body with preservative gel, but he's confused about which one he should use.
So this is the wrong stuff.
Right, so she knows what...
Yeah, it's a blue gel.
So Rachel normally does this, does she?
Right.
Rachel normally does this.
Rachel's dog, she should have done this.
Blue gel.
Just keep yourself nice at the angle. Put it on. Pull up and down her legs under her feet and...
What does it do?
We're actually embalming her.
Right.
Keeps her embalmed.
But this isn't embalming, and Paul, with his lewd comments, certainly isn't treating the deceased with respect and dignity.
You know, mate, Paul?
Yeah, well, get in there.
Oh, that's a bit you've missed.
Can you? Do you do that?
Yeah, just give it a fucking quick go. I'm sure you've touched someone out before, haven't you? Right. When we get a man next time, I'll let you do him.
Thanks, Paul.
You're right, mate. The first time you've heard another man's doctor in your hand, isn't it?
Okay, once again, we see the code of practice saying one thing, professionally trained staff, they know what they're doing, they've got the skills required, and a very different situation in practice where we have totally untrained staff. In one case, somebody who's only worked there for 2 days, doing a job on a body which really requires a degree of skill and care and professionalism, which clearly isn't evident here.
Despite staff complaints, Tom records further evidence of understaffing. With a coffin so heavy it requires 6 pallbearers, 4 men are left to struggle on. Immediately afterwards, the pallbearers are an obvious physical pain.
I thought that other one was...
You can see the back inside of it.
Yeah, you put that... You put the other pack on that, is it?
We put, when we bring them in, we put them down to 6 men. Because we're so underbuffed to start, we can't. We've got to put up with it.
What we need to all get together and say, look, we're not doing this. This is out of order.
I know. You'll be either I'm going up my knee after that. My knee's gone and my eye, my fucking shoulder's gone.
Included as part of their professional services, FPL promised to dress the deceased in any clothes families provide.
People still believe in bringing clothes.
So they still, okay.
We won't dress her unless we have the time. Like, you know, if I ever had my assistant that I've only won a year and a half for, then yes, I would dress them. But until using that personal time, I won't be doing dressing.
Staff admit that bodies are only dressed if the family choose to view, and most don't.
Do you have to dress them?
No, I won't dress them. I'll just lay it out where they belong.
We had loads of time.
Yeah.
Do they want him dressed or?
The clothes just dumped into the coffins, in the bags they arrived in.
What's that? The clothes, is it?
Yeah, that's very well.
Yeah.
It's staying in there, I suppose.
Yep.
It's another instance of being misleading in a way, because the company's saying, we will do all these things for you, yeah? Except what they're really saying is, we will only do all these things for you if you bother to check up on us. And if you don't find out what we're doing, we're not going to do anything that's going to cost us money or take up time. We're going to have as easy a ride as possible behind the scenes, as long as you don't find out.
In part two, a shortage of fridge space means that bodies are left to decompose in hot weather. And staff reveal virulent racism, even towards mourners. Our reporter, Tom Ellis, has been undercover with Funeral Partners Limited for 3 weeks.
It's a bit hard this day,
is it?
He's still working alongside driver bearer Paul, who's taking him to a garage at the back of a derelict building that FPL use for excess storage of bodies.
Thank you.
Always look up something.
Soon after Tom's visit, the lease on the old lockup runs out, and while the fridges are being moved, the reduced storage space is causing problems back at the main branch.
Where's he going?
Nowhere. Staying on it.
Is that because the fridges are full?
What?
The fridges full, are they?
The bodies start stacking up.
No space. Yeah. I'm gonna have to move this woman onto the wash table.
And to make things worse, it's one of the hottest weeks of the year.
That fucking casket up there, that one's for viewing as well. God, bloody hell, does it stink?
One body has a condition that means it keeps leaking fluid. A good embalmer, with plenty of time, can fix it. But Rachel says she is overworked, and the heat is making things much worse.
I'm leaking lately. It's fucking annoying. It must be the weather. They're breaking down quicker.
It's really hot.
It doesn't smell too good.
No. It's in the ambulance.
They try to mask the smell by spraying perfume.
Time job, but he rolled that on for you and he rolled it back on.
Oh, Kenny.
Kenny was there, yeah.
Right. One's across this
one. What's the point of taking the hearse?
Fucking hell. Oh!
It's just the hearse, just taking it.
At the funeral, the pallbearers noticed a smell as soon as they opened the carriage doors.
Oh, Mr. Matthew. Hello.
He's off. He's gone. Oh, wrong bit of me. How long has he been in the casket, boy? It's been a while.
A what?
Last Thursday?
A week?
About a week. That's good for any bit of meat to go off, isn't it? Especially the warm weather. A little bit of warm weather.
Yeah, it got hot, didn't it, last week?
And soon, the deceased widow, who gave us permission to use this footage, notices the smell too. The widow we see being racially abused paid FPL over £11,000 for her husband's funeral, although that did include over £4,000 for a cemetery plot. In the same week, the old fridges arrive at their new location, from a derelict old lockup to a warehouse that FPL staff claim isn't even fit for the storage of vehicles. One of the Gilman's pallbearers is shocked at what he thinks the company is about to do.
I can't believe they're putting the fridges in there, really, do you?
Where, what, in there?
Yeah.
No.
What do you think they're doing without stretchers without that?
Yeah. So it'll all be up here?
Yeah, everything will be based up here.
The warehouse walls are covered in mould, and the fridges sit on one of many puddles caused by the dozens of leaks in the roof.
Well, I don't really try it myself. Well, the whole family knew that their mum or brother was it. I mean, it doesn't, in the end of the day, it doesn't matter if nobody ever knows.
Mm.
But if you knew that your family, one of your family, you wouldn't particularly think it was good, would you?
No.
The Gilman branches, now owned by FPL, are spread across South London, so often provide funerals for African and Asian families. They are particularly proud of their relationship with Ghana, where the Gilman family established a business and charity in the capital, Accra. One of the funeral directors explained why else it made sense to have good relations with families from certain countries.
You know, when you have a Jamaican family, you know they want show. Same with Ghanaians, pretty much. Isn't it?
Yeah.
They want show, so you have to offer them.
Mm.
You know, I normally say, look, if I see that they've got money, I can say, look, do you think about 6 horses? Just give them these weird ideas.
Mm.
Or we're going to see them, show them the caskets, and they see the caskets. Oh, that casket is very nice, and you can see it's like £5,000.
Mm.
That isn't really appropriate business behaviour, because you're taking advantage of the fact that you've got bereaved people in front of you, they are not thinking clearly, but they are concerned about having a good funeral because it's part of their cultural situation. They want things to be done properly, and he's taking advantage of that. He's abusing this position of power he has over them because they've come to him for guidance. It's not really showing care and attention to their particular needs. It's more a case of finding out where their weak spots are, taking advantage of those to make more money. Again, it's bad business behaviour.
Gilman's funeral service relies on its reputation with the Asian and African communities, but their business is not something Paul shows any respect for.
If you sent all the fucking black people back to Africa, that's what they all reckon they come to.
I mean, everywhere in the world, Africa would be overrun. Yeah. And they'd go back into the dark ages. Mm. Why do you think, aren't these fucking coons over there fucking rabbits? So the best thing to do is set up an hospital, and if they have the kids, block them. So they can't ever have kids. Mm. Right, and if they survive, they survive, and if they don't, they don't. And then one in, say, 100 can have a kid.
What do family think? Families think if you they heard you say that thing?
Don't give a fuck what they think.
Yeah, but like, what about all the Ghanaians and stuff that we do?
Better about them as well, wouldn't it? You'd be in full family employment, wouldn't you?
Dang.
Yes, you would.
And the racism wasn't confined to Africans.
Burn the fucking drive, you fucking peggy. It's 20
years. Well, then we should worry.
They've got airy menus.
Because although it's obviously an immediate crisis...
Who's that?
Assuming that Greece does in effect go bust.
It's just airy people, aren't they?
An immediate crisis.
When Tom spends a day working at another FPL branch in Slough, he soon learns that racism is evident there too.
It's obviously, and up there is the coffee room.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And the holy wash.
Right.
You know, the packet for all this, you know, you wash that shit.
My neighbour asked me, he's Muslim, he asked me when I'm taking the flags down. So when I leave.
Is that what he said?
He said, well, Jubilee's over. I said, where? What about the football then?
No.
Fucking Muslim bastard.
I should have burned the bastard.
I nearly said, what one do you want then, the Al-Qaeda or...?
Yeah, the orange.
You've got Poles, you've got Pakis, you've got Blacks, you've got Somalians, you've got all that little cotchle together, and it just brings the whole area down. It makes it what it is, as you're told.
Right.
Nobody's got a good word for Slough, it's just Slough.
Yeah.
Coming up, we go undercover at the higher end of the market.
Cause that's not even on the street. It's just stuck on with sticky tape.
And me, the man in charge of Funeral Partners Limited.
This goes against everything we stand for. This is pure disrespect of the deceased, and we will not tolerate it in our business.
Our second reporter, Luke Den, has been working at the top end of the funeral market in affluent West London. He's been given a job by Dignity PLC, who own over 600 funeral homes in the UK and 35 crematoria. They conducted over 62,000 funerals in 2011, and with profit before tax of £39.8 million last year, they're the only funeral company listed on the London Stock Exchange. Luke starts work as a trainee funeral arranger in a Dignity branch in Bayswater, West London. It's part of a group of funeral directors established in 1880 called J.H. Kenyon, who once carried out state funerals. Dignity choose to continue to trade using the family names of the businesses they bought up. Luke is working alongside a man who's been with Kenyons for over 40 years. They're preparing a body for a family viewing. And it seems that the high-end appearance doesn't always bear up to close scrutiny.
Do we do this one? Because they don't put these on very...
Eh?
They don't put these on very well, do they? Look at that.
Yeah.
That's not good. How much do these cost us to make, do you know?
What, these?
These coffins.
About £40, I suppose.
They only cost about £40 to make?
Yeah. Like chipboard veneer. Hmm?
Oh, yeah, it's just chipboard. And how much does it sell for? What's this one?
Well, it's a consort, isn't it? Yeah, it's £440.
Wow. That's quite a markup.
Yeah, oh yeah.
But yeah, those just look like they're going to come off. Has the quality gone down?
Mm-hmm.
Has the quality gone down?
Well, yeah. Yeah, of course it is.
Mm. So it's just so cheap. Look, that's coming straight up.
The nameplates Luke sees at Kenyon's are of equally poor quality.
That's not even on straight.
and are used on even the most expensive urns and coffins.
It's just a 100 sticky tape.
Do we still do these ones when it's a burial, the plastic ones?
That's the only ones they'll do. We used to have the engraved ones are better.
They all used to be engraved, didn't they?
Yes, even...
Everyone.
But I've had it too.
Every coffin used to be engraved.
Every coffin, every engraved
every
one.
Every single one, yeah.
Everything we did used to be engraved. It's could you imagine any of these being exempt?
Were they ever rubbed off by then? Were they just like...
They rubbed off for some time before they get to the
this is, when you go like this and you go... right?
Yeah.
Sure you go...
around it. But why don't they just engrave them?
Because they won't invest in another engraving. It's expensive. For a multi-million pound company, we can afford a bloody engraving.
It's tacky. Tacky to say the least. It's cheap.
He even puts them on traditional sometimes.
I've got one. Well, what was it? We had that casket in, didn't we? That £20,000 casket with one of those stuck on the side. With sticky back tape.
Well, one last week, one stuck on the top, so I just grabbed it. Yeah, it's not good, is it?
No.
Oh, well, that's it. The £5,000 casket. No coffin cross. And it was a Roman Catholic, so it's what I said that I think really...
What's interesting here is that we see staff who clearly are professionals because they're actually, to some extent, even upset, I'd say, about what they're actually having to do now. So they're saying, well, we shouldn't be doing this is quite embarrassing, it shouldn't be happening in this way, but there's nothing we can do because costs are being cut.
Dignity also add a substantial markup on coffins and own the company that makes them.
Well, obviously, I haven't been down to the workshop, but the coffins that come in, I've had a look at some of them, they're not great, are they? Like, a lot of them are just like MDF.
Glen Coffin will cost you, what is it,
£350.
Now, to actually get that, go to the manufacturer and buy that from the manufacturer, you're talking about £40, £50.
Yeah.
£300.
But coffin markups aren't the only way Dignity make money.
When you get a bill from Dignity, the first two charges that you'll notice are for arranging and conducting the funeral. Now that's £1,315 and includes liaising with and making payments to external parties on your behalf. The second charge is for caring for the deceased person and that's £660. So that brings your bill up to £1,975 before you've even added extras such as a hearse or limousines. Now also on your bill is a section labelled external payments.
These are charges paid by Dignity to external suppliers.
I know that Dignity add hidden extra charges on things like horse-drawn carriages, death notices, orders of service and flowers. And that's despite having already charged you £1,315 to make those payments on your behalf.
Customers are promised that Dignity will be open, honest and straightforward, charging no hidden extras.
From the florist, they get around about 25% commission.
25%?
In certain areas, it's 30%.
They also charge a commission on horse-drawn carriages, as Luke discovers when he calls the supplier.
£700.
£700?
Yeah.
Okay, that is quite a bit cheaper.
Yeah, but that's what you was quoting.
It was Kenyans. They quoted £1,150.
Yeah.
Is that quite usual then? Is that quite usual?
Yeah, about the right price, yeah.
Okay, they take a commission. Okay. All right. Thank you very much for your help then.
Thank you.
Cheers then. Bye-bye.
So they can check any of those.
And when a printing company visits, they reveal to Luke that Dignity also see a benefit from customer stationery orders.
Does it all kind of work on a commission basis and stuff like that then? Or like with the jobs which come in through Dignity and that sort of thing?
Dignity see a benefit.
Yeah.
That's a politically correct way of saying that, isn't it? I mean, the price you see on the bottom of everything that you get is the price the client pays.
Yep.
The invoice that Dignity gets...
It's obviously...
maybe slightly different.
Yeah, of course.
They even take a cut from the placement of obituaries, as Luke shows when he calls a newspaper for a quote.
My name's Lucas. I'm calling from J.H. Kenyon, a Dignity funeral director. I'm looking to place a death notice for Monday's paper.
Okay, so when you're ready, if you can start reading me the wording.
Okay, so it's died peacefully.
Yeah.
On August 7th, yeah. 2012.
The quote is for a 72-word obituary, but Luke is given two different prices.
Okay, and the account, it'll be £320.77.
Okay.
And then the full cost of the family is £366.50.
Okay, that's great. Cheers then. Bye bye.
Bye bye.
There you go.
Classic example of misleading pricing here. The external service provider charges Dignity companies less, consumers pay more. Misleading pricing, incorrect information, a clear breach of consumer law.
Dignity declined to take part in this programme, but provided us with this statement.
We are a caring and responsible company and wholeheartedly support the regulation of professional standards within funeral services. Last year, 99.3% of our clients surveyed said we met or exceeded their expectations, and over 90% said they would definitely recommend us.
On the question of charges, they told us,
we do not mislead our customers. Our terms and conditions do not say that we pass on all charges for third-party services at the cost to us. They refer to these costs being estimated when funeral arrangements are initially made, and to the actual cost being the charge eventually paid by our clients. As is customary in the profession, we pass on items such as cremation, cemetery, doctors and clergy fees at the cost to us, while suppliers of items such as flowers, obituaries and stationery offer us and other funeral directors a discount. This is not a secret.
On the question of coffins, they said,
our coffins are of directly comparable quality to and competitively priced with those provided by other funeral directors. From 62,000 funerals performed in 2011, we received fewer than 10 complaints about our coffins. The provision of a coffin cannot be considered separately from our overall service. In 2011, our average invoice per funeral, including the coffin and all external payments, with a net profit margin of 14%, was £3,270. This is slightly less than the average UK cost of a basic funeral.
On the question of nameplates, they said,
plastic nameplates have been in use throughout the funeral profession for many years. Metal nameplates are not permitted for cremation, and in London, 80% of all funerals conducted by Dignity are cremations. We have 300 engraving machines in use in our funeral homes. However, printed nameplates provide flexibility given the wide range of languages and religious symbols called for by the many communities we serve. They do not wipe off and are widely used throughout the profession.
And regarding transparency,
we have owned J.H. Kenyon for 23 years, prior to which it was a listed public company. Our ownership is made clear inside and outside our branches and on all advertising stationery and literature. The vast majority of our locations have the Dignity logo shown prominently on the signage. We are no different to many high street businesses that trade under the various brand names they own.
In part four, we confront the man in charge of FPL with our evidence. Over 3 months, our reporter, Tom Ellis, found evidence of racism, disrespect and poor practice in Funeral Partners Limited, who own 70 funeral directors across the UK.
Sing the ambulance.
We asked Chief Executive Philip Greenfield to respond to our findings. We asked him if the bereaved wouldn't think his businesses were still independent, family-run funeral homes.
If they enter any of our premises, what they will see is a certificate on the wall which says clearly that this business has a trading name and it is owned by Funeral Partners Limited, part of a group. We do not hide this.
But the Battersea branch has had independent family funeral directors in the window for 3 years.
What you have there is a branch which is about to be refurbished. It's one of six branches. It's the next one. If you go into the premises, you will see exactly this statement which I've just talked about.
So why is it then that a local pastor who's done many funerals with Gilman's, clients of yours, had no idea this was no longer a family-run business?
That's a good question, and I don't know the answer to that question, because every single piece of literature which we produce has on it that Funeral Partners are the owners of this business. We do not profess to be an independent family-run funeral business. We profess to be a group of family-oriented funeral directors, and that is a true statement.
The ultimate owners are the shareholders, of which August Equity are one.
So what percentage of shares do August Equity hold?
They hold 60%.
So the information on their website is incorrect?
No, it depends on your definition of ownership. In many accounting senses, 51% is ownership.
Yeah, and they own 60%. So why is August Equity not mentioned anywhere on your website's literature or in any of the branches?
The role of August Equity is to provide me with the capital to realise my vision. I set up this business. I am the one who set the values. I am the one who set the principles on which this business will be run.
But they say they're the ultimate controlling party. You say they're 60% shareholders, which would still make them the owners.
They're clearly shareholders in the business. I run this business. I am responsible. I carry the can for this business.
That's a £600
one. I thought that one was...
You can see the fucking size of it.
Yeah, you put the pack on that, is it?
We put, when we bring them in, we put them down six men. Because we're so unfucking staff, we've got to put up with it.
We would never risk the health and safety of our employees by asking them to carry something which is beyond their capacity. That's the first thing. The second thing is we provide in every single one of our vehicles a wheeled bier, which is used for moving objects which are too heavy. And thirdly, every single one of our branches has been subject to internal risk assessment. We would identify these issues and we would not allow our staff to do that.
They have done that and have often had to struggle with four men carrying a very heavy casket or coffin. So why has that happened?
I appreciate that you've brought that to my attention. There will be an investigation into this, and if it is happening, it will be stopped.
And their assertion that it's happening because they're understaffed is...
is completely incorrect. The staffing of the Gilman business today is greater than it was when we acquired it.
You buy a cheap bingo set, and apparently all these old girls and old boys love it in a nursing home. And the idea is when they die, they may use Gilman's. I don't know.
Funeral directors are local businesses. Funeral directors live in the community, they're of the community, and it is perfectly appropriate that they should engage in community activity. Mr. Moyes' suggestion that this is some way of bribery is completely wrong.
I don't think it's just bribery. I think he just says it's brought in huge amounts of business in, I think, the Slough branches. And the idea is that when they die, they may use Gilman's. He's very honest about the motives behind these bingo nights.
The motives are you are in the community, you give something back to the community.
So Mr. Moyes has misunderstood the reasons for...
Mr. Moyes is representing this in a rather jocular, inappropriate manner.
Am I turning myself okay?
Firstly, I would say in response to this, I am horrified to hear that anyone in our business would have used a shopping bag for this purpose. However, what I would say is it is not always inappropriate to use a bag of some kind, and we provide those bags for the right purpose. In this case, what is totally unacceptable to me is that they've used a shopping bag, and secondly, that the language which has been used is completely and utterly abhorrent.
Look at that one, it's gross.
Oh, don't pick it.
Well, I can't leave it there.
Why not?
The family will see it.
It's right there, suck it.
Completely inappropriate comments. Again, I would apologise unreservedly to anyone who is caused distress by these comments. However, what I would say, we stress to all of our people that at all times they should act as if they're in the presence of the family. This is the personal control we ask them to apply to themselves. Of course, there is gallows humour in this country. It's everywhere. People use it to diffuse stress. But in this case, it is completely inappropriate and it goes against our guidelines. We would never, never condone it. I repeat, these sorts of comments have no place in our business and I will not tolerate them.
Another member of staff holds up an urn full of ashes, shakes them and says, do you know what her favourite song was? Shake, rattle and roll. The other three members of staff laugh.
This goes against everything we stand for. This is pure disrespect of the deceased, and we will not tolerate it in our business. The investigation is underway. When it's complete, appropriate action will be taken.
Showing clips of pornographic videos on mobile phones with a body in a hearse on the way to a funeral.
These are the same issues. Our policies are very clear. No use of mobile phones at all, anywhere, in the performance of our duties.
But with all due respect, how can these things be happening on a regular basis?
These things are... The first time I've become aware of these things is when I received your communication. They will not happen again.
But until Barry using that personal phone, I won't be doing anything.
Do you promise that if families bring in clothes, then the deceased will be dressed in those clothes?
Correct.
Repeatedly, and I'm talking several times a week at least, if a body wasn't being viewed by the family, staff didn't bother to put the clothes on?
Our policy is clear. If clothes are provided by the family, we will dress the bodies.
What's that, the clothes, is it?
Yeah, that's better. Well, yeah. Is that staying in there, I suppose?
Yep. Repeatedly, the bag was simply placed in the coffin with the body, in some cases in a plastic shopping bag.
But, to be fair, do you know that they were not then dressed at a later point?
Yes, because we also filmed the coffin lid being put on, screwed down and put onto the hearse.
This is not acceptable practice, and if it happens, it will be stopped.
What did you think?
I don't think it's right, myself.
The car warehouse that you refer to is, in fact, a major project of investment for this business. We are spending in excess of £200,000 to develop a state-of-the-art embalming theatre and mortuary. This is being done within that building. No bodies will be placed in that building until such time as that project is complete.
I'm smelling something. It's very sensitive.
I don't think this is an appropriate comment. I think it's abhorrent. It is completely against everything we stand for. And what we're seeing here is exactly the same sort of thing that I spoke about before. If I had been aware of that, if any of our management had been aware of it, we would not have allowed it.
He said it in front of the other three pallbearers, one of whom was our reporter, but two members of your staff didn't even raise an eyebrow, let alone condemn his remarks.
We will be looking into this.
Your investigation will reveal various things, but one thing we know for certain is that Paul racially abused a bereaved woman at her husband's funeral.
And
what
I find
that, to Herbie about that.
And I find that completely unacceptable. I will apologise to that family unreservedly.
And will you be offering a refund?
I will offer her a refund, yes.
If I see that they've got money, I can say, look, do you think about six horses? Just give them these weird ideas. Mm.
What you're talking about here is a description by somebody for whom English is not his first language, and what he's explaining is that we offer choice because we understand what these communities require. So we offer the choice.
You do promise, though, in your literature that your staff will be professionally trained?
Yes.
You stand by that promise? All your staff are professionally trained?
I do, indeed. This year, we have delivered more than 7,000 man-hours of training into our business.
And do you think that training has been a success?
For the most part, our training has been a success. All of the people in our business will feel totally let down by the actions of these individuals, as I am, as my management team are, as the clients will be. This is unacceptable to us. We make clear what our ethos is to all of our people. I'm very grateful to you for bringing these to our attention because we've launched an immediate inquiry into this internally. I have also engaged an external firm to carry out a review of all of our procedures and how well they're applied in the business.
We understand that the investigation is still ongoing and will report back later in the series. Roger Gilman made clear to us he now has no managerial involvement in the FPL-owned businesses featured in this programme.